citizens get to have a say in terms of who will represent them, and eventually these representatives hopefully will become true to what they promise and deliver on those promises. However, we know that that might not happen. The second one, it's also a recognition that in elections, it's the most accessible given that the franchise has been extended. I think in Asia, we're the first country that has had elections, we're the first country that basically enfranchised women. Although I think the voting age can be scaled down to 15, as in some other countries, but the extension of such franchise does not necessarily mean that we have better representation. So, and when you have elections, you eventually have an indirect influence on public policy. In elections, you can basically decide who the policymakers are, assuming that, of course, that the electorate will be sovereign. If there's a positive side, which is that you have a franchise and that you have an indirect influence on public policy, there's a negative side of it also. And the negative side is that when we're so engrossed in election, we forget that elections would just be one form of political participation. We confine our participation to elections alone. We forget about the more important foundations of governance, which is one, that you have to organize groups, or groups have to be organized. If you look at, let's say, indications of the level of organization in the Philippines, you can point to two studies. One is the recent study done by Gerald Clark on civil society organizations, where he mentions that actually the Philippines doesn't have that large density of civil society organizations compared to many other countries. Of course, he worked chiefly with either that the number of civil society organizations in the Philippines is actually not that high. The more important finding of Clark, which somehow testifies to this negative side of electoralism, is that they found out that many of these listed organizations are actually organizations that are mutual benefit organizations, rather than public interest or public benefit organizations. What Clark doesn't focus on, however, would be that there's also a decline in terms of many of the organizations that are quite important, basic sector organizations, such as, for example, labor unions. If you look at the data on labor unionism, the number of labor unions have actually, the number of laborers who are part of unions have actually declined as a proportion of the total labor force that could be unionized. So that's the first negative consequence of electoralism. You actually have limited the form of political participation to elections. The second one, which I think is very obvious in the Philippines, is that participation in elections is really specifically vying for elections would be limited to professional politicians. So it depends on who those professional politicians are. Many countries have professional politicians and they do well because they're part of a political party, right? So that's one part of it. The second one, I think, which is quite interesting, and maybe some of you might be interested to pick up on this issue, specifically in this election, we all know it's a pretty tight race. That tight race may actually be affected by what some would call a machinery. And whether there is such a machinery that is operated by national level candidates. We have noted in the past that such machinery actually has not operated. I have a conclusion, but I'd rather not share it. But the conclusion is something that I've actually started with. The machines are delusional. Whether it can be proven to work this time, it might be best really to capture this moment, at least for a discipline. The last point I'd like to discuss would be with respect to what are the post-election scenarios. I think that is equally problematic. We have four candidates who have a chance to win. We have Poe, Duterte, Binay, and Loas. Two of them have machineries, and those machineries can be used to cheat. What I'm saying is that the results of the election will most probably be highly contested, regardless of who wins. If you observe the structure of all political campaigns, national campaigns in the country, the ones that we're seeing, then the ones at the back, the ones that are not seen, essentially, I think those people are guarding each other. They have lawyers in the more important places. So they know exactly what the opponent is doing, and I'm pretty sure that they're gathering evidences so that eventually, if they need to file a protest, if someone who doesn't accept that particular result would easily bring about all the documents to show that this lawyer is affiliated with this firm. That's why I say it's crazy. And I don't think that even if we will have a minority president, and we've had a minority president in 1992, that this thing can be solved by simply bringing about a rainbow coalition. That coalition might not come into being in the way that it did after Ramos.